Welcome to the Epilepsy Foundation's videos on epilepsy and cannabis. Cannabis, also known as cannabidiol, CBD, for treating epilepsy has been a topic of interest for a number of years. The Epilepsy Foundation developed this peer-to-peer education for healthcare providers about CBD and epilepsy to provide important factual information and dispel myths and misperceptions about this topic. Recently, a purified pharmaceutical form of CBD was tested, like other prescription medications, for two forms of severe epilepsy, Dravet syndrome and Lennox-Gastaut syndrome. Both syndromes start in childhood and are associated with very difficult-to-control seizures, multiple seizure types, and other developmental problems that can progressively worsen. These videos were designed to share what we know, what we don't know about CBD and epilepsy, and includes published data on the first FDA-approved CBD product for treatment of Dravet and Lennox-Gastaut syndrome. The participants share their knowledge and experiences about what to consider about CBD in general and tips for counseling people with epilepsy and families. The project was funded in part by Greenwich Biosciences. The Epilepsy Foundation editorial board of epilepsy.com and staff had complete control on the creation and review of this content.
Hi, my name is Dr. Joe Servin, Editor-in-Chief of Epilepsy.com, and I want to welcome you all to the Epilepsy Foundation video on cannabidiol for epilepsy. I have two guests, and I'm going to let them introduce themselves. Barry?
Hi, I'm Dr. Barry Goodell, University of Wisconsin-Madison, and I'm the co-editor of the medication section of Epilepsy.com.
Hi, I'm Anu Patel, Section Chief of Neurology at Nationwide Children's Hospital in Columbus, Ohio, and I'm also the Medical Cannabis Editor for Epilepsy.com.
So, Anu, what is the indication for cannabidiol?
Yeah, so based on the clinical studies, the FDA approved this for anybody 2 years and older who have seizures that are secondary to Dravet syndrome or Lennox-Gastaut syndrome. What's important about that label is that even though many of the studies were done in children, there were adults in that study, and therefore it's greater than 2 and greater, but there's no age limit. So this is both for children and adults who have seizures because of Lennox-Gastaut syndrome or Dravet syndrome.
Is there anyone we need to worry about in terms of a contraindication that this is not the medication for you just off the bat?
You know, Epidiolex is also in sesame oil. So if you've had an allergic reaction or a reaction to sesame oil, it's not all peanuts or nuts allergies, it's just sesame oil, then that medicine is contraindicated. Also, if for whatever reason, if you've had exposures to CBD or cannabidiol and had an adverse reaction, then again, this product would not be for you.
How effective is this?
What we saw in the pivotal studies for Dravet syndrome and Lennox-Gastaut syndrome that led to the FDA approval was very similar results. You know, you saw around 39% to 45% what we call median seizure reduction. What that means is that those seizures had reduced by that percentage compared to when they were started. A responder rate refers to how many patients in the studies had at least a 50% or more reduction of their seizures. And again, with through the platform of studies, you saw about a 40 to 45% of patients having at least 50% or more reduction of their seizures. Interestingly, in one of the studies that we ran showed efficacy at a lower dose range. So the other ones that I mentioned are usually at a 20 milligrams of medicine per kilogram of the individual. In one of our Lennox-Gastaut syndrome studies, we also looked at a lower dose to see if that was effective. And we did see that at 10 milligrams of medicine per kilogram of patient, we saw efficacy and we saw a 39% median seizure reduction. And again, when you compare those all to placebo rates, there was statistical significance or differences between that. So that's the gold standard way of knowing something is effective.
How similar are those numbers to what is already approved for medications that isn't cannabidiol?
Well, I think I'll start and then I'll defer to Anup. I think, you know, we do need to keep in mind that there have not been head-to-head trials in similar populations of patients. So I think that is, we need to understand that. Having said that, when you look at all the studies that have been done in Lennox-Gastaut or Dravet and all the other therapies that are available, the response rate is about the same.
Okay.
This is a medicine works similarly to a lot of other medicines, can be very effective for some, and is another option, which is always helpful for our patients who do not respond to the therapies that we've tried. And so it's encouraging to have this, but by no means is this a magic bullet or a fix-all for everyone who has seizures.
Let's talk about dosing. I know you brought up the 10 milligram per kilogram, 20 milligram per kilogram. What's the dose that we're looking at from a practical standpoint? How often does one take it, and how much are we talking about?
Yeah, and I think the important point here is it's all going to be weight-based. And okay. So you're going to take the amount of medicine that you need, and if you want to start slow and go, or start low and go slow, that's how we would recommend it. So you could start at 5 milligram per kilogram per day, but let me explain what that means. It means that you're going to take 5 milligrams, multiply by how many kilograms that person weighs, right, to know how many milligrams that person will take. So in some cases, you may be on as little of 10 milligrams to 100 milligrams, where in other cases, for adults specifically, who obviously weigh more than our little or smaller children, you know, they might be able to have to take 1,500 milligrams twice a day. The medication should be dosed twice a day. That's how the trials were done. That's what the data suggests.
Barry, you know, one of the things that people are already asking is, well, I can get a version of cannabidiol in a dispensary or other location that may provide this. Is the dosing that was seen in the trial translate to the dosing you go and use in these other products that say it's cannabidiol?
The short answer is no. I think we need to understand that Epidiolex is a purified form of cannabidiol. So we know exactly what we're getting in every dosage form from dose to dose. So I think it would be a mistake to try to translate from what we know from the clinical studies over to these other preparations. The question I've been asked is, well, are these other formulations, can we consider them a generic? No, there is no generic version of this molecule.
We really don't know how to dose these vernacular or artisanal products, right, because we don't know what's in them. We don't know the consistency, how much CBD, and et cetera, and they're not tested. So it is very important for everyone to know that the results from the trials cannot be extrapolated to any other product. The results in the trial and the dosing that's recommended from the trial only pertain to Epidiolex, the purified plant-based formulation of CBD.
What kind of side effects were seen in the trials? At least we'll start off there, and then we'll talk a little bit more about side effects.
Yeah, I think the more common side effects were sedation or tiredness, some nausea, diarrhea, some stomach GI upsets.
The other side effect that was seen was increase in liver function tests, transaminases. We know that cannabidiol can inhibit one of the cytochrome P450 isozymes, P450-2C19. Why is that important? That enzyme metabolizes the active metabolite of clobazam, which is going to be, as you well know, a commonly used drug in this population. What was seen fairly consistently was that levels of the N-desmethyl clobazam were significantly increased. And it's reasonable to assume that that may have been contributing to a lot of the sedation.
I think it's an important point. And one of the things that we could do, or what we did do, was either lower the dose of the clobazam, or in some cases the Epidiolex, and that sometimes made the sedation go away, and you were able to keep that seizure control at the same level as you did before, but not have that sedation of a significant way. And it's really a balancing act, and what you can do with that is really going to be working with your family, your patient, to be sure they understand what to look for and then how you can handle it.
Does the other side also come into play, that is lowering the dose of the other AED if they happen to be on a joint combination therapy or something?
You know, that's one of the recommendations I make to many patients, regardless if it's, you know, Epidiolex or other medications. You know, when you add a new medication, it is sometimes the original medicine that needs to be lowered because that's what's causing the effect. I think we're quick to blame the new guy on the block.
And one example might be with the interaction with valproic acid. It may not be a pharmacokinetic one. It may be a pharmacodynamic interaction. We know from the clinical trials that transaminase levels could go up. Now, fortunately, there was no cases of liver failure. There was Hy's law was not violated, so that's a good thing. But nonetheless, we're going to have to monitor for transaminases. But that did tend to occur at higher doses of cannabidiol, and especially in conjunction with valproic acid. Again, we don't know what the mechanism is for that particular interaction. So I think in terms of how we handle that, we should be monitoring periodically, both before we start CBD and then periodically, at least for the first few months.
And when you see that, or if you were to see that, again, one of the things you'd want to consider is lowering the valproic acid dosing, or again, the Epidiolex dosing. You have two options as it relates to that. During the trials, when we were able to do that, in all cases, either lowering the cannabidiol or the valproic acid, we were actually able to get those liver enzymes back to the normal range.
Kind of what's your take-home main message and point for our viewers, listeners out there with regards to the prescribing of this medication and what they need to be concerned with?
Sure. I think what the clinical trials have informed us is that this has the potential to be a very efficacious medicine and generally well tolerated. There are some side effects that we've talked about that may be more than troublesome. And there is the potential for drug interactions. So I think that needs to be on everybody's radar when they're prescribing this, is think about this. There is guidance in the package insert about potential interactions.
Anu?
Yeah, I think that what we learned from the trials is that both at 10 milligrams per kilogram per day and 20 milligrams per kilogram per day, that Epidiolex can be effective for a certain part of the population who have seizures from Dravet and Lennox-Gastaut syndrome. In the case of Dravet syndrome, this is now the first FDA-approved medication for Dravet syndrome, so we're very excited about that. There are obviously other FDA-approved medications for Lennox-Gastaut syndrome. However, you know, Lennox-Gastaut syndrome patients are very difficult to control. So having other options is very exciting, and so we're really pleased with the results, and we're really pleased with the methodology that was taken to make sure that these results are sound and follow the scientific method.
Well, I want to take this opportunity to thank our fantastic guests, Barry and Anoop. And I want to also thank you all, the viewers, for joining us today for the Epilepsy Foundation video discussion on Cannabidiol for Epilepsy. My name is Dr. Joe Servin, and I am editor-in-chief of epilepsy.com. Thanks so much for joining us today.